Let me just say a quick word introduction then of Stephanie and Michael, and then ask them if they might come. They're going to, as is our custom, make some preliminary remarks, and then mostly we want to have a conversation to engage. Those of you who are in chapel, I think we're provoked to think in ways that maybe you haven't thought about, and that's our hope in these conversations. That's our hope in your time at seminary, that you think about things the way you haven't thought about them before, and maybe there are some aha moments in the midst of that. Stephanie Summers, as I mentioned, heads up the Center for Public Justice, an independent, nonpartisan, civic education, public policy think tank of sorts, as we learned, people that do a lot more than just nothing, if you were in chapel this morning, based in Washington, D.C. Graduated from Kenyon College, a master's in organizational nonprofit leadership from Eastern University. She's held leadership positions of significance in the Coalition for Christian Outreach, a major campus ministry in the Pennsylvania area. She was executive director of the Open Door, a church-based youth center. She's been very engaged in youth issues, millennial issues. And as you'll see in the book, Unleashing Opportunities, she's got a heart for the least among us. And that comes through so clearly in everything she does and has written. So we're just thrilled that Stephanie is with us and has brought along one of the fellows of the Center for Public Justice, Michael Gerson. Most of you know Michael from his twice weekly column in the Washington Post, a regular visitor to the PBS NewsHour, Face the Nation, NPR, and on the list goes. Formerly a top aide to President George W. Bush, head speechwriter, as well as a senior policy advisor. A very significant voice for many of the global health initiatives in the Bush administration, sharing some of that with us in chapel. More to come, been very engaged on issues of AIDS relief in Africa, malaria initiative, the president, the fight against global sex trafficking. He was instrumental in that era for funding of women's justice and empowerment issues. He's really been a poignant voice in the public square that folks have a hard time stereotyping. And so I think you'll find plenty to be provoked by, no matter where you stand on the spectrum. We've mentioned the books. I might also mention, as I mentioned in chapel, he's a theologian at heart, or at least by training, as an undergrad, and was preparing to enter a ministry of some sort when God put his hand on him and took him to Washington, D.C., and has landed in a city desperately in need of voices that we've heard in these columns and on television from Michael over the last decade and a half. So with a warm welcome, let's bring Michael and Stephanie up, and I'll let, I think Michael's going to make some opening remarks, and then Stephanie, and then we'll turn to questions from the audience.
Thank you so much for a kind introduction and a great welcome here. I've felt really welcomed, and it's much appreciated. I'm a little bit talked out. I just gave a chapel address, but I would mention, I mean, I would have made the worst pastor in human history, and I think that's because, you know, I'll talk a lot about humanity here, but I don't really like people very much, and that's a drawback. I was actually going to study for a PhD, and teach. That was going to be my goal, because you don't have to like people if you're a teacher. But it's but took a different path. I mean, got you know, there's a Frederick Buechner quote where he says, "Listen to your life, and there comes points where you have opportunities or moments of decision where I was a risk-averse person who promised myself I would take whatever risks came. That wasn't easy in a certain way because it's not my nature. But it brought me to places I didn't expect. And that's how it often happens. I'll just mention a couple of brief things here. One, we have a terrible problem with our discourse right now in American life. If Stephanie and I were to adopt the methods and tone of the first presidential debate, you'd have to call the riot police. It would be example. It's a warning. It's a spectacle. Much of our politics is that way. But I guess the encouraging thing to me is that I have found when you look above that debate in a certain way in my life on international issues, there is a deep and durable coalition between right and left that has saved millions of lives in the world and gets very little attention. It's involved traditionally liberal human rights and global health groups and traditionally very conservative religious people. I call it the PEPFAR coalition, but it really is people who are not just making compromise with one another. They actually have genuine, deep agreement on what America should be doing in the world in some key areas. I have found hopeful. You know, when I was in the White House, as I mentioned earlier, it was one of the most bitter times in American political history, modern American political history. And there were alliances that were possible on some of the great issues of our time. So that's kind of above the debate you're seeing. So this is, you know, I just finished a book chapter with Raj Shah, who was President Obama's head of USAID. It was a project on the future of foreign assistance. And we had genuine, different experiences and genuine agreement, and that's really possible. And then when you kind of look below these presidential debates into communities that are solving problems, and that's what the book does, that's what Unleashing Opportunity does, looks at issues like the foster care system, which unbelievably, we go into some of the details, in some cases has become a pipeline for sexual trafficking. In America, and how people are lost to that system, or juvenile justice reform, which has happened in a variety of places, Texas and Georgia and Missouri, with unusual coalitions between libertarians and Christian activists on a more traditional route. And it's been some real progress on serious human needs, and that's what the book was about to some extent, that when you look into communities and you look at needs, you can see real progress. I won't go into all the examples of of how bad our discourse is. This is what I deal with in most of my life, is this political debate that is not taking place at a very high level. So we have a badly polluted, I think, democratic environment. The answers to that, though, theoretical answers that translate, I think, into solutions. The first is really a structure, governmental structures that recognize the essential role of associations, private associations in our common life. A liberal society that allows the existence of communities that are not liberal in that sense, with a government that's involved in only the most extreme circumstances. This means to solve problems, you need pluralism. You need people who are motivated by their faith to serve others. And that requires a public life that accommodates belief, even deep disagreement. Even strange and objectionable ways of life, that's the nature of pluralism. Some of this depends on public forums that I think welcome this. This has been one of the real contributions of this Center for Public Justice over the years, has been to defend a principled pluralism, to defend associational rights, this tradition of Abraham Kuyper and sphere sovereignty. Individuals are important, the state is important, but really this tradition draws attention to the broad realm between the individual, the state, where opportunity can be encouraged or undermined. Strong families and religious institutions, charities and community institutions that build habits of cooperation and care for the spirit. This is not as easy a case to make as the appeal to anger and ideology, but it's the serious framework that we talk about in unleashing opportunity. However discouraging this presidential election is, there are other levels of government and community that matter greatly, and there are achievable goals in pursuing the common good, which we talk about in these cases. Another requirement I would just throw out there, it deals with democratic values that uphold pluralism: tolerance, humility, patience. There's a Rousseau quote that asks, can we live at peace with those we regard as damned? Rousseau actually says, no, you can't. And actually, I don't think we have much choice. Genuine commitment to pluralism requires, in the words of constitutional scholar John Anazu, to endure strange and even offensive ways of life. And that really requires a kind of certain democratic virtues and habits. It may sound naive, the question of political philosophy is always, will the powerful voluntarily disarm? Will majorities give up on majoritarianism, oppressive forms of majoritarianism? And that is tested in a variety of ways. You know, will evangelicals really defend the religious liberty of the mosque down the street? Will political liberals support institutional pluralism even at the height of their cultural power? And I can only point out that this is deeply rooted in the American ideal, in classical liberalism, which measured victory by defending the conscience of others, has roots in Burkean conservatism, engaged not in culture wars, but in building community in concrete, local, and practical ways. And it's probably worth pointing out that everyone has a stake in that pluralism. Those who embrace majoritarianism may someday be in the minority on some issue. Those who abandon the protections of pluralism may someday have need of them. And those who deride democratic virtues are undermining social peace and self-government. So Christians, I think, should make distinctive contributions in these areas. Sometimes we need reminders. You know, politics involves great passion. I know that. I see it every day. Our system is designed for deep disagreement, but it is undermined by mutual contempt. Practice civility, not because we agree with other people, but because we see the image of God in every life. We can't dehumanize our opponents, even when they dehumanize others. I think this has been a struggle in this political season, particularly if you read my recent columns. But I think that one of the advantages that Christians maybe bring to these discussions that others may not have is an understanding that politics, I argued today, is very, very important. Justice is absolutely essential. But politics itself is not ultimate for Christians. As Christians, we have faith in a kingdom that can't be defeated in a primary, that can't be tarnished by lies, that can't be torn down because it was not built by human hands. And the values of that kingdom are not identical to any party or movement. They stand in judgment of every political party and movement. And our ultimate hope is not fragile. It's not going away, even in this political season. In my belief system, despair is heresy. And that's something I've been trying to remind myself. So.
How's that? All right. So I have this problem, which is I have big hair, and I usually wear big earrings, and I never have a place to put these things. But I'm really grateful that this is one of these and not one of these, because these are the worst. All you hear is my hair and my earring, and it's terrible. It's bad. Thank you, Michael. And thank you for Rick and for everyone else who made it possible for us to be here today. It's really a delight. It was funny, on the walk over from chapel, connected with Dave Curry, who I knew this, but he didn't remember that I was one of his students once. I actually have some credits from Gordon-Conwell. And he said, you were in one of my classes. And I remember the grade I got. Because I didn't get an A, which is why I'm doing what I'm doing, and what you're doing is very good. So I do want to acknowledge that these types of conversations that the Center for Public Justice goes around and has, that sort of fall into this category of public justice in the political arena, are some of the thorniest conversations that you are going to get yourselves into, if you're not in them already. For people who are leaders of churches and in faith-based organizations, these are tough conversations. And I think in our current political climate, they're tough. I think they're going to continue to be tough. And so part of what I want to do in framing up my remarks is talk about this to people who are going to lead in that space, or who already are currently leading in that space. Because I get questions from pastors and leaders about this stuff all the time. How do you, as church or faith-based organization leaders, work with the people who you work with and help them understand the work of the church, help them understand what it means to be a citizen in a political community, and on and on. So I'm going to kind of frame up a couple of remarks that go in that direction, and then maybe we can have a dialogue about anything that, you know, we raise where you're like, tell me more, or I think what you're saying is heresy, go back to Dave Curry's class. I want to give you three examples of what I mean when I'm talking about this. So I'm paraphrasing three different email messages that I got this week from leaders of churches. One, we publicize our church's policy that church staff and members don't use church resources to solicit support for political candidates or ballot referenda, which is in line with the law. We had folks on Sunday standing outside on the sidewalk before and after worship asking people to sign a petition for a particular ballot referenda. When staff talked to them about it, the response was, "It is our constitutional right to stand here on this sidewalk and do this," which is true. For us, staff, this isn't a legal issue so much as it is about discipleship, where what we want to help clarify for our folks is that it's a matter of prudence on their part about the best way to engage fellow congregants on these weighty questions that require deliberation and consideration. It is not settled by declaring that one has the right to do it this way, and in fact, an important consideration for them may be undermined by their approach. One. Two, we're a purple congregation that generally stays away from discussing anything related to politics in order to keep the peace. But we're in an election year where many of us are struggling. Some of our people openly despair, others openly disdain the other side, and some of our people, this pastor included, want to shout a pox on both your houses, which I go around saying a lot, so he's quoting me, quoting Shakespeare. How can we help our people see beyond November 8th? Three, this one is in response to an invitation that I issued to someone, to a pastor, to join an off-the-record discussion about a federal-level legislative proposal that would seek to balance civil rights protections for LGBT persons and civil rights protections for religious institutions, to which the pastor responded, "I'm so excited about this. I think about and talk about these questions every single day. I just left a conversation 2 hours ago with one of my members on this." So I want to zoom out from these kind of things and for a few minutes and talk about the role that you play as leaders of churches and faith-based institutions. And I keep using faith-based institutions, just recognizing that the stats are lots and lots of folks in seminary aren't going into pulpit ministry, right? You're going to lead faith-based organizations, and public policy and these questions of politics really matter in those organizations as well. How you can work to equip Christians to think as citizens, how you help people in the pews who are used to thinking about themselves as members of the institutional church and as members of Christ's body, think about the role that they play as citizens in political community. So, big question, what are political communities for? Have you ever thought about this before I ask this question? I know some of you have. So to think about this kind of a different way, if I asked you, what is the church for? You could give me an answer, or Dave Curry would flunk you, right? What is the church for is a question that you wrestle with, but there's not a lot of thinking, teaching on this kind of what is political community for? For many Christians, our membership in a political community is something that we think about one time every 4 years, right? And many of us think about it unwillingly. And most of the time when we think about it at all, outside of the presidential electoral framework, what we think about is a feeling of weariness from the culture war and a concern to keep the peace, whether that's within our own congregations or between the organizations that we love and lead and the community at large that may, like the fruit of our labor, the service that we render in communities, but think about that fruit as coming in spite of the roots that we have in Christian thought. So it's great, we're really glad those people believe that. We don't like it, they're weirdos, but we're really glad they're helping here. Christian roots are sort of an anachronism at best in this framework. I'm most frequently told, though, when I speak at events like this, and especially folks who are younger than I am, so under 40, that when one kind of confronts the shallowness of today's kind of American political climate, the complexity of questions that we face as Christians in a pluralistic society, one that shares not all our views, and the extent of the injustice and its roots in the world and system and structures, that being a faithful citizen seems an impossible task, utterly futile. And folks often say, I don't know where to start, I don't know how. So one of the pieces that we try to frame up in our book are really some concrete examples of what that could look like. But I kind of want to lay the thinking behind this role we play as citizens in speaking to you guys who are going to have a whole bunch of people working with you who are wondering these questions. How do you help lead in that space? At the Center for Public Justice, part of our vision is to equip Christians to understand that citizenship is a common calling, right? It's one we share. Our citizenship responsibilities are a direct response to God's command to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God, as articulated in Micah 8 and elsewhere. Micah 6:8. See, should not be a pastor. Yet, God's good invitation to citizens to participate in shaping our political community so that justice is upheld has become an invitation that most of us just dread receiving. Is it possible to rediscover God's good purpose for our citizenship? Can we respond to God's good invitation to citizenship with joy? And I argue that we can. In fact, we must give an enthusiastic yes to when we receive that invitation, because this is what it means to serve our neighbors as citizens. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the theological frame in which we think that fits. So let's start at the beginning, right? God created the world. Everything that God created was good. The story of creation itself is a story of development and order. And right from the beginning, God creates humans with the capacity to take part in the continuing process of cultivating human culture. God commands humans to fill and cultivate the earth, and our response is the ongoing act of further developing the potential of what God created. Culture unfurls as humans respond to God, bearing God's image by using the capacities that God has given us for modeling the creativity of God, working together to build families, to develop art and theology, and fashion a physical world that's characterized by things like art and architecture. Unlike many familiar political narratives that you might have learned if you took like a poli-sci 101 class in undergrad, political communities in this understanding don't begin with human will or a social contract. It's true that God doesn't establish explicit political communities at the creation, right? But the mandate to humans to cultivate culture means that the genesis of political communities, of ordered communities that allow humans to flourish, is found here. We're made by God with the capacity to bring order to our common life, and the responsibility humans are given by God to further develop the creation points to the foundation of political community. And concern for our neighbors, something with which we're very familiar, is the animating principle behind the development of these structures. You know that's not the end of the story, though. Everything that was good was corrupted by evil. Humans didn't obey God's direction. Our rebellion means every human relationship is distorted by sin. And God chooses to continue to give the goodness of the created order and establish and humans to participate in further developing what God made. But the potential of government authority is also distorted as a direct result of human rebellion. So after our rebellion, any task of any potential government within a political community can't be limited only to promoting the good so that citizens flourish. It becomes necessary that any potential government also restrains evil, and at times compels citizens to conduct themselves in ways that are good. This also isn't the end of the story, right? We remember that God sent Jesus Christ, the Lord of all, to redeem all things. Jesus' death and resurrection actually provides the way in which all things, humans, institutions, and the physical world, are ultimately reconciled to God and to one another. Until that day, every bit of what God made is under God's authority, and the call on all human life is to recognize Jesus' reclamation of all that God has created. So fulfilling God's calling for us in God's world means reforming what has been distorted, starting with the world as it is right now. Our work as citizens is to shape political communities, which must be lined up with God's good intention and purpose. Many of us get, because we pay attention to congregations, we pay attention to the work of faith-based organizations, we get what it means to serve our neighbor in really tangible ways. It's easily understood, based on the teachings of Scripture, easily applied, serving one's neighbors, loving the least among us. So, you know, take an example. Members of your congregation are tutors in a school whose students may not have a parent at home to help them do their homework at night. But it's a lot harder for us as Christians to understand what it means to serve our neighbors when it comes to our political community. Continuing with the previous example, it's harder for tutors to think and act like citizens. So consider, though, like at the most local level of political community, how citizens might respond to God's invitation to participate as citizens for the well-being of their community. Citizens begin raising thoughtful questions about the quality of the facilities or the teaching that affects the kids that they tutor in a particular zip code. Shaped by an understanding of God's intent for the unfolding of culture and knowing the importance of understanding and interpreting God's word, the citizens begin to invest time in understanding and discussing what structural factors might be at play that are leading to these concerns. They examine where potential injustices reside and what could be done so that things more fully line up to resemble the just political community that God intends. Some of these are things that are not public policy, right? But some of them are. And as citizens ask these questions, they begin to fulfill their calling as citizens, participating in the unfolding of the political community. And in some cases, this may mean advocating for reforms, or working to help shape new laws, or working to change administrative structures to ensure a more just political community for everyone. So as leaders of faith-based organizations and churches, we all need to remember that God invites us as citizens to examine our political communities with surely a critical, but ultimately, as Michael said, a hopeful diagnosis. We must animate, scrutinize, advance, and when needed, correct through reform our political communities. Citizenship is our common calling. In calling us to citizenship, God invites us to develop our abilities to accurately discern the well-being of the political community in which we live and to act accordingly. In so doing, we respond to God's call to do justice and to love our neighbor. I'm looking forward to our discussion. Thanks.
We want to open up the conversation with questions, not sermons, questions. So If you can say it in three sentences, it's probably a question. If you need more than three sentences, it's probably not a question. So just because you're here to engage Michael and Stephanie. So, for example, let me start the first question. The microphones around the room. Michael, you made the comment that cynicism is the attitude afforded the comfortable in politics. And Stephanie has talked about the way in which the pox on both houses is an attitude too frequently expressed in our times. Can you elaborate on that cynicism and the danger of it?
I think cynicism in almost every case is a failure of empathy. It's a failure to put yourself in the position of others. It's the point I made this morning, or emphasized this morning, is that it's the luxury of comfortable people. If you are in a foreign country that needs malaria, nets and medicines, if you're in a community that has dysfunctional schools that betray your children, where there's where there's violence, then politics is not some optional element. It's actually essential because human justice is essential. It's the point that I often make when people just talk about they've given up on political life, is that there are always matters of justice at stake in any society. And I think that this is a failure of imagination to some extent. It's a failure of empathy. If we can put ourselves... this is at the root of a lot of our problems in public discourse, that if the Christian approach is defined by or seen as the defense of its own institutions and views, then it will have failed. Christian engagement, the purpose has to be the service of human dignity, a universal ideal that applies to everyone. And that's what Christians should be known for. And so you have examples, recent examples of, say, a Catholic church, if you look at Spotlight or other movies, that was oriented towards defending itself, in the process, it discredited itself. And then you have a new pope that touches people with skin disease and washes the feet of Muslim prisoners and engages in these very Christ-like activities and has provided an entirely different model of what it means to be a Christian in the world than the previous Catholic example, the most recent Catholic example. It's been a pretty extraordinary transformation and really maybe a model in a certain way. When people see the Pope, they see the reflected image of Christ, and that has a tremendous power. A power greater than the type of power that's just organizing for your own interests as one interest group among many. So when I see Christian public involvement that's just, I'm in this to defend my rights and my people, that's like any other interest group in American life. And that can't be the way that Christians are defined in our public life, although they often are.
Stephanie?
Sure. So I'm really conscious that all the millennials that work on my staff train me to not talk to millennials about millennials, but you asked this question, so I'm going to have to answer it by talking about millennials, but maybe I'll talk to the millennials in the room. We were at Park Street Church last night, and the title of our event was called How to Be a Christian in an Election Year and Not Hate Everyone. And you laugh because you know the feeling. Some folks on my team have written a couple pieces for hermeneutics, CT's kind of online thing for women, around kind of the opt-out culture, sort of waving the white flag on our political engagement, right? Why? And Mike is so good when we travel because he's my heavy and he says things very straightforwardly like, you know, ignoring this stuff is the privilege of the comfortable, and I don't have to say that sentence, which is great. But it's true. Our general persuasion in the face of the pox on both your houses feeling is to opt out, or at, you know, best, get Facebook mad, and then opt out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, ultimately for me, I think I'm right, theologically, you can check me on this. I think that that level of despair and disengagement actually lie about God. And I think that the way that we need to reshape our thinking on this is to continue to remain engaged in this space in spite of all of the things about it that we see that we don't like. There's very little that I see in Scripture that essentially tells people, it's not lining up with the way God intended, go ahead and quit. So I think there's a faithfulness piece for us. I want to affirm the thing that Michael is sharing at this level of thinking about this as other-focused. And I think that's a helpful corrective to some of the things that have been affronting in our modern political discourse, which feels very self-oriented, self-individualized, as opposed to looking for the well-being of others. So we're
actually organized by fear.
Yes.
We have a discourse that sometimes is organized by resentment of the other, which is the exact opposite of what I was trying to.
Right. Yeah. So what we're trying to engender in these conversations is really a focus on a theologically informed way to combat, I mean, heresy, in terms of telling the truth about God's good purpose for this work and why opting out really isn't an option.
Who wants to ask the first question? Two hands back here.
If you could just also just say your name so we... Yeah. You're not like a faceless, nameless person.
Hi, my name is Misty Davey. Stephanie, in relation to the question that the pastor asked, how do you solve the problem in our congregation with the people out on the street asking for signatures, could I make a suggestion? I'm not sure if you're familiar with Concerned Women for America.
I am.
But Beverly LaHaye and Dr. Tim LaHaye, when I was with them some years back in Washington, had the idea of having prayer chapters in the local churches because, as you may know, they came from a church as a pastor and wife. And with these prayer chapters, they then would notify from the Washington office where we were what was on the hot seat about to be voted on by the Congress. And it worked very well. And the illustration I'll give you was there was AT&T going to have, and they had put it before Congress, and it was about to be passed, a proposal to have in their business advertising dial a porn number, and it was geared for 10, 11, 12-year-olds. And what brought it to the highlight is three pastors had the young kids dial this number because it was in the preview stage in their pastor office and do these sexual things after what they heard. And it was so atrocious, they then turned and would attack different little kids in the nursery. So they approached different pastors, said, what do we do about this? The pastors turned to this organization I was with, Concerned Women, and we put it out to all the prayer chapters. There was one in every church in every city. And within a two-week period, 14 days, they went to prayer and got so agitated over it that they flooded their congressmen and senators' offices with so much email, and they began to look deeper into it, and it got null and void. It got dismissed, and they turned around the Congress and thanked us for getting the word out because they don't always have time to read and get to the bottom of this. So my question is, would it be a possibility that you and your position could suggest prayer chapters and have a coordinator, because we do it for political things, and have a coordinator in each city manning and getting these issues out, because I think as leaders and church pastors, we are forgetting the greatest tool we have, which is prayer.
So there's a lot there, but I appreciate the story and the example. I do think that these are the types of conversations that congregations really need to have around how we do this well in the structures that particular congregations are operating in. And I do think that you're right, that the prayer component is really integral, not incidental. So I want to affirm the heck out of that. That's really important.
I would just add, because I agree with that, that the notion of calling is really very important in all this. I think that pastors and churches have a role in the moral formation of their citizens and the elevation of the ideal of justice, and that is a perfectly valid role. But I think that pastors and churches don't really have the policy expertise to talk about a variety of issues. I see that sitting in the pew, where I know more sometimes than what leadership is talking about. And that's going beyond their role. It's not, you know, the calling of policy on immigration policy or healthcare policy is the calling of informed, committed laymen within the church. But when it comes to that level of specificity, that's really not the role of religious leadership. And it can be discrediting when it's simplistic. So I've seen that happen. Because I am the heavy and can be blunt, there was a writer named Russell Kirk that said that he would much rather go to his bartender than his priest for political advice. And you know, that's not an area of expertise of people in ministry, necessarily, the policy expertise. I think it's perfectly valid to say, these are the broad principles of justice that should inform a Christian in their engagement in public life. But we have people in our congregation, genuine experts, who are the leaders. They're the leaders on this. They have the calling. And so some of this is just an understanding and recognition of the diversity of calling and the important role of laymen in leadership sometimes when it comes to political matters.
Can I tag off this too? I mean, so one of the things that we're pretty conscious of organizationally, and you know, again, I'm in front of a room full of future pastors and faith-based organization leaders, so please hear this. You set the tone for folks understanding a biblical perspective on government, period, right? Government has a high calling to fulfill, right? Government's not everything, but it's not nothing, and it's animated by God. And so when we disdain government or government officials, rather than call them to their high calling, we're creating a set point for folks in our pews that actually just kind of puts us on the gerbil wheel of the dysfunction that we have in a lot of our discourse. So the opportunity to say the calling is justice and really answer and lay out kind of that biblical theme there for our folks is incredibly important. And then affirming both the vocational calling of folks who are in public service, but also our vocation as citizens, often because there's this tension and we don't want to have confrontation or conflict in our congregations, or we don't want to be in a place where we're giving air to, say, this particular issue but not to another. We just don't talk about it at all. But what that leads to is sort of a gutting out of what Scripture actually calls us to in this space and kind of a biblical vision for what it is to serve God both vocationally in politics but also as citizens.
So let me just poke in one more time. Having been at that Park Street conversation last night, you talked, as you do in the book, about foster care and actually the connection with sex trafficking. Talk about how the church has been and can be engaged in foster care in concrete ways, the CASA example,
sure.
For example,
sure.
And then the connection with sex trafficking. how that political issue is a much more local issue.
Yeah. So let me just give you a brief kind of orientation to the book, because that will help contextualize this for folks who haven't had a chance to see it. So we wrote the book so you can read it in 2 hours, so it's not this like wonky policy dense thing. So Michael does a really great job kind of setting up the cultural diagnosis. I talk about biblical principle, and Katie Thompson on our team, she's a great journalist, writes these really wonderful stories of like what this looks like in action. We wrote it for millennials. So it's, if you like it and you're a millennial, we did it for you. If you hate it, tell me so we can do it better next time. So, but the upshot of the book is, you know, we're really seeing this pox on both your houses, kind of white flag, I'm out of here stuff. So what we're trying to say is, okay, you may, you know, be thinking about November 8th and want nothing to do with anything related to politics because of the presidential election. I mean, that might be where you're at. But these concerns of justice matter all the way down, even to your backyard. So the 5 issues that we talk about in the book are ones that are salient in every single community within, you know, a mile drive of where we are right now. We could unearth all of this stuff. And that's where we're trying to go by saying, if you opt out, you're opting out on addressing these pieces. And we're also making a case for how these are shared solutions, right? So the subtitle of the book, it's Unleashing Opportunity, Why Escaping Poverty Requires a Shared Vision of Justice. We're also trying to amplify a really important principle, which is government isn't everything. Public policy isn't the magic bullet solo. But often, the work that other institutions, families, churches, businesses, et cetera, play is also complemented by public policy that either helps them do their job well or addresses specific places where it's not being done well. So we're examining these things through this lens. So one of the things that we talk about, if you do any work in foster care or any work on human trafficking, you will be familiar with this. So for those of you that aren't familiar with this, the FBI has recently documented a big link between kids who were foster care involved who are domestic trafficking victims. There's a whole host of reasons why this is, but we actually in the book talk about it as the foster care to trafficking pipeline. And it's not because foster parents are selling their kids into human trafficking. It's because foster care as a system is a structure that doesn't create a level of stability for folks, and they're really vulnerable. Foster care, just in terms of vulnerabilities, young people in foster care are some of the most vulnerable members, if not the most, in American society. Unfortunately, pimps, traffickers kind of create an alternative family, right? So we have all these stories when we're doing these interviews. It's just heartbreaking. You know, girls who basically said, yeah, the first person who threw me a birthday party my whole life was my trafficker, right? You know, they call themselves my daddy. Like, I mean, just these awful, awful, reprehensible things. We make a case in the book for how churches can really intervene in this. And, you know, some of those things are things like fostering kids. Some of it is helping congregations wrap around families who foster. So it's not, because foster care is not easy, and particularly as more and more people become aware of this foster to trafficking pipeline link, fostering kids who are trafficking victims is intense. It's a really intense thing. And so the needs for support for these families if they're in your congregation are so substantial, right? So these are all things that have a dimension that really is, you know, not necessarily a governmental public policy shift that needs to change to help maybe God's people respond in some really tangible ways. But one other thing that we noticed as we were studying, we were doing these interviews with people, they talked about a place where there's a gap in the system, right? So part of foster care is to try and reunite families, right? So the intent is always to help increase the ability for a child to be reunited with their family first before the parental rights are terminated. But in the court system, basically what happens is you have a series of hearings over and over again for these kids who are going in front of judges to find out about sort of what the best thing to do with this kid at this particular moment in time is. And what they found is kids were going up in front of a different judge every time. And they had a different social worker every time. It's just the nature of the systems and structures that also need change. But there was no one kind of consistently advocating for the kid that was a consistent person. So when we were interviewing people and asking, okay, so for someone who is not going to foster a kid tomorrow, but wants to deal with kind of changes that need to happen in the system, what's like the most important thing that they could do? And every person we interviewed said, become a CASA. I had no idea what that was. So it's a court-appointed special advocate. And basically, you are a volunteer within the court system. You get serious training, and it is a high bar. So I would encourage people who are trying to get an A in Dave Curry's class to not become a CASA until you're done. But you become basically the representative for the kid through their season in the system in front of these judges. So you are the only consistent person whose job it is to advocate for that child in the courtroom, and they'll ask you your opinion. It's heartbreaking work. Everyone I talked to who's been a CASA said, you know, you will have this experience over the course of a couple years where this kid will, what they decide is the worst thing in the world you think for this kid. And they even asked you what you thought and you told them and they still did it. So not to be entered into lightly. It's actually amazing to realize how few court systems, family court systems, have CASA programs. And it's something that is a kind of nonprofit entity that folks can work alongside, started within the court system, so government officials recognizing we need this, and we don't have it, we don't have a way to get it. So CASA structure is a really good one.
Amen.
Yeah, I would only add just in a more general way that maybe one way to look at this is there are a couple of important callings on an issue like this. There's the calling of compassion by which you're helping an individual beat the odds in a circumstance. You're a mentor, you're a CASA, you're helping an individual, you know, in God's image to achieve in a difficult circumstance. The key there is often people need to know that they're loved, that someone in the world cares for them. That is the greatest human need. It's the key to child development. It's the key to a lot of social problems, and it means that there's a human element that has to be involved there. So that's helping people beat the odds. But the role of public policy and the role of the wonk, which I will defend, how do you change the odds in people's favor? How do you create systems that are actually better at what they do so that you don't have as large a need or that people can overcome it more generally, can find economic opportunity, are not lost in the foster care system? We saw, we write about examples of kids that were just lost. I mean, no one tracked them. So that is systemic. And that's more to do with social justice, actually, is how you, through expertise and knowledge and experience, construct systems, social systems, that better serve human beings and reward their hope. And so I think that's actually important. It's important, too, and they're not obviously mutually exclusive, and people often play both roles, but it's one way to think about it, about what public policy does. Right. To some extent, the book is a defense of public policy, the idea that through knowledge and experience and wisdom and, that we can make a difference in the lives of others in key areas, in early childhood development or in the juvenile justice system, for example, by encouraging alternatives to incarceration. That's one way to look at what the book is. It's a vindication of public policy.
And I think I would just say one more thing with this. The piece around trafficking on public policy, there's a place for folks to be active on this issue area right now, which is really around two sets of policy that, unfortunately are at the tail end. They're not addressing the kind of sled into trafficking. But, in a lot of states right now, people who are trafficking victims are prosecuted for crimes, for for prostitution. And so there really needs to be policy change at the state level to not prosecute victims for these. There's a young woman that came up to us last night and was talking a little bit about work, you know, also of holding accountable people who buy sex, right, as a place where there's not a lot of enforcement on that side at all. So another place. And then the other piece is really for people who, again, work within the court systems and structures, right? There's not a lot of screening that actually diverts victims of domestic trafficking out of the justice system, right? So who actually need rehabilitative services, right? There's only one place in the whole country that has a verified screening tool. It's Washington, D.C., and they developed it because what they saw were so many young people ending up in the juvenile court system that actually were trafficking victims who, you know, because of this, and we talk about this a little in the book, because this is their new family, they actually protect the perpetrators, right? So they talk about this sort of, this is my uncle, this is, and so instead, how do we, you know, set up structures within the courts themselves that don't ever get anyone court involved, but get them into rehabilitative services and aftercare and such. In the larger community of people who do work on these issues, the larger secular community, they really get that Christians hang in there with people because of our commitment to the image of God in every person. And this is also true in the juvenile justice reform space. We had the privilege when we were writing this book of attending some kind of large conferences and events about people who are like the top advocates in these areas. And people would sort of take us aside and say, hey, you know what, like we're really grateful because Christian people actually really hang in here. And then they tell us some story about their experience in the system. So there's really a lot of examples and hope out there of what we're able to do when we kind of take what we believe is true into these spaces.
Some more questions. Reminder questions here.
My name is Jonathan Faulkner. So Michael, you talked a little bit about the discourse on the higher level being rather just nasty at points, to use my own term, on both sides of the coin, there are what are essentially false narratives that drive this almost violent discourse. How do we, as pastors, as future pastors, because we'll face this in our own congregations, address those, move people back to the middle so we can have these conversations and actually get work done for social justice and activism?
Great question.
It is a really great question because you do find on both sides the feeling that the other side is both uniquely evil and uniquely ruthless. They both, so you have a symmetrical belief that that's the case and that it justifies their own intensity and on the issue itself because the other side is playing dirty, I have to play dirty. And both sides believe that. And it results in a really tremendous decline in the quality of discourse. I think that's where we are right now in a lot of ways. So some of this is a reminder of the basics about why we are civil people in public, okay? And that is, you know, not because we're weak or because we're compromised, but because we have a certain view of human dignity. And if we're not representing that view of human dignity in our public life, we're not having the message of Christianity in our public life. That is the evidence of our most basic belief, is how we treat others. And when, that can easily be discredited and undermined by the manner in which we approach other people. So some of this is training Christians in what the distinctives that they should bring to public lives are, the things that they contribute in our common life. And you know that is not a unique anger and intensity. That is a unique belief in shared dignity and honoring the image of God in other people. So that's an important teaching, I think, of a teaching of the church. Some of this is also, I don't know the best way to put this, but some of this is the bubble effect of modern media, which pastors face all the time, which is it is now possible to pick sources of information that reinforce your views and prejudices and where they have an economic interest in intensifying them, in getting hits and getting cable viewers and getting radio listeners, that they actually have an economic model that is to incite people's views, reinforce people's views and incite them to another level. How do you break through that? Some of this is urging people to have varied sources of information as an element of what citizenship means. Mm. Citizenship is not gathering as much ammunition for your own views as possible. Citizenship is actually learning about public policy issues in sophisticated ways and acting in ways that serve the common good. So that really is, some of that is just clarifying what citizenship means, as Stephanie was talking about earlier. And part of that is, citizenship means nothing if it's not informed citizenship. And that really does require more effort than, having Fox on all day, or MSNBC, by the way, where you just have, the feeding of your prejudices. And then maybe some of this is just in, one thing a pastor can do, as I said, is not to spout policy views, which I think can be discrediting. But maybe it's to expose people to social problems that are kind of different than the ones that they normally see. And so, if you're in media, if you're in a conservative bubble or a liberal bubble, you have a certain view of what the problems of the world are. And when people are exposed to a different set of problems, it can be eye-opening. When young people, in my experience, spend time in the developing world, for example, and see the way that people live in the developing world, the disease challenges of the developing world, they see a different set of public policy issues and of human and moral issues than they're just used to seeing. And that, I think, can kind of open people's eyes. I've had the experience myself of being challenged by someone to enter into a circumstance. I spent a day on a needle exchange truck in DC where they're, making sure that you don't have shared needles to get AIDS and Hep C. And wasn't even sure what I thought about the public policy that related to that. But I ended up with a very different view. I thought that these programs are in fact quite important. And that was only because I had exposed myself to a different set of issues than I would normally deal with. So there's very little experience, there's little substitute for that. And that relates to kind of the empathy issue as well, is how do you imagine yourself in different social circumstances? I think pastors can play that role to challenge people's imaginations, to think, to imagine themselves in different places and in different social circumstances than, particularly comfortable suburban congregations.
I would only add one thing to that, which is creating forums to practice this, because there's a lot of models of it being a mess, right? But there's not a lot of models of like having this conversation in a reasonable tone of voice, right? We've had this conversation for an hour and no one's yelled at each other, but there's a lot of fear that we're gonna have a conversation about religion and politics and we're gonna be screaming at each other pretty quick, right? So we don't do it. Creating forums in which these conversations can happen that build on the biblical counsel that's there.
Yeah, modeling discourse can be really important. I do a number of events with E.J. Dionne. I don't know if you know him, but he's a liberal writer on the Washington Post, the page of the Washington Post. And people come up to us afterwards, because we have deep disagreements, but civil discourse, and people come up to us afterwards and say, we just don't see models of this. We don't see models of it on television. We don't see models of it you know, in other places in our common life. And so, you know, that can be the role of faith-based institutions, is to model discourse. And to say that disagreement doesn't have to be dangerous. In fact, it's what I was trying to get at, where we have a system, we have a democratic system that's designed for disagreement. I mean, that's what the assumption of the founders was, deep disagreement. But we have a system that really does not work, where the engine gets fouled up when you have contempt and hatred. That really does undermine the workings of public systems. I think modeling discourse matters.
So. Let's just take a couple more questions. We're cognizant of time. Back, Matthew.
Thank you very much. I have had a president said to me, I'm really looking up to the church because you guys are the moral guarantors. He's a Christian, and what I felt was his need is help. He needs help from the church in the context where the culture has grown into the church is different from politics. And a pastor, as a pastor serving that capacity, I know it takes a period, but what do you think, especially for Michael, working with somebody like a president, you know, what do you think is pivotal as a Christian to support help for that kind of person? Is a Christian in that public setting and he feels isolated and needs help? What do you think would be something very significant to, it's like in terms of helping him?
Okay, just so I understand the question, the question, can you repeat it one more time, just so I can get a handle?
So, a president who is a Christian,
right,
who feels isolated, it's like the church is not giving the kind of support he needs,
yeah,
and he's in that situation where he needs help, and he's asked for help, what do you think would be some significant way to provide help?
That's a very good question. I mean, this is a case where sometimes, and we don't credit this enough, and maybe it's not common enough, but sometimes there are public officials that want to do bold things in the cause of justice. I meet good people in government, and you know, we don't often credit that. But you could have a member of Congress that wants to do something like Senator Corker from Tennessee on human trafficking that would make a huge difference in the world. And you have a politician with a vision that's trying to push ideas. Not as a church, but as laymen within a church, they really need support, deserve support. And that is, I think something we don't take seriously enough. So on these public health issues that I was talking about, we now have had two presidencies that were deeply committed to this set of issues, one Democratic, one Republican, very, very different. That has required a constituency of people that say we care about these issues an advocacy community that supports politicians. I found directly when I was in government and I wanted to raise an issue like a malaria, that it was within the governmental structures and try to get something done, it was absolutely essential that people within the church in particular took an interest in these issues and showed that there was a political interest. And there was some constituency for people who don't normally have political constituencies. I mean, there are a whole bunch of people internationally and domestically that don't hire lobbyists. You know, there are poor people and sick people. Every interest has a lobbyist. But who in the world is going to be the lobbyist for people dying of a preventable disease or young men and women in a foster care system that are taken into sexual slavery? Who's going to be their advocate? Who is going to provide that voice in American politics? That's a really important question. And it's one reason I think advocacy matters. that you know, the, what you're doing in advocacy, when you're joining with others in a cause, and you're communicating that to political figures, is that you're showing there's a constituency for compassion. I would hope the church would play that role. There has been examples where they've played that role, but it probably should do it even more.
Question right here, front.
Hi, I'm Drew Brown. I'm an infant at Gordon-Conwell, so I'm 3 weeks old. you guys talked a lot about calling, and one thing I'm pretty sure I'm not called to is the pastorate. For someone who I think I want to be a professional layman, if issues of public policy, if that is something that really gets me going, and I'm a history major, history master's here, and history reconciliation is something that's really, I'm very passionate about, how would I start even looking into a career in public policy or a career in the DC area or local?
Great question.
Yeah, there are a bunch of different avenues working for a member of Congress. I highly recommend, this is a very specific piece of advice, but you know, I learned about politics and policy on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C. It's the best place to learn this. It's not easy to get those jobs, but in fact, it is trains a generation of policy leaders who go into a variety of fields. I think that Washington experience can be really pretty valuable. These things can happen in local government as well, because we have a federalist system. A lot of policy leadership comes from states. If you're looking at juvenile justice reform, it's not the federal government that's leading that effort. It's Texas and Georgia and other places. That's part of our federalist system, and I think a way to be engaged on these issues is for your state to become a leader or an example, and that requires public officials kind of playing that role. My avenue was the ability to write. Often you have to, if you have some skill that you can contribute, that it helps when you're trying to, there were a lot of lawyers on Capitol Hill that were interested in issues that couldn't write. And it was a comparative advantage to have some skill like that. So I found that to be, the ability to write and think actually matter in American politics. Can be a real contribution.
I would add, one of the things that we discovered is that the field ed placements really matter. Field ed requirements, trying to find a place that takes up some of these issues or works alongside organizations that do is a pretty important kind of component of that. It's interesting, we have had a partnership for a long time with Princeton Seminary. We're the only organization in Washington, D.C. that takes Princeton field ed students. And they just tell us every year when they send us a whole bunch of students and we have to pick like one, which is hard, that there's no other organizations that are willing to sort of like move into the space with, the technical requirements, someone with a terminal degree in this field, but then also thinking about these questions in such a way that would help meet it. But I think, if you look at the trends in theological education, the need to develop more and more of those types of things as more and more people who are in seminaries don't go into public leadership, but lead in faith-based organizations. So I would say an internship in a faith-based organization that's thinking about its public policy might be a place where you could also be very helpful and, it would complement an experience working directly in government.
Yeah, and sometimes it's the difficult route, but people start organizations, either advocacy organizations or policy-related organizations. I just had a fairly extraordinary experience where I went to Dharamsala, India, to see the Dalai Lama, and I went with a group of 20 under 30-year-old peace advocates that are doing community healing efforts. I mean, in but all of them in conflict zones. So South Sudan and Nigeria and Lebanon, and it was pretty extraordinary. Just to see, these 20 people who had undertaken efforts to heal deep divisions in their communities. Sometimes they're just young people that feel pretty isolated often. It's difficult work. You talk with them individually. It was one of the reasons why it was pretty extraordinary. When they got together, it's created a sense of community and support for one another. And then we spent 2 full days with the Dalai Lama, who was just pretty, it was pretty amazing. But it was, I cite the example because I was just tremendously impressed by people that take on the most durable problems you can possibly imagine, the most difficult divides in the world, in situations where they're often at risk. Almost every one of them undertook these efforts because they saw someone that they love either killed or had acts of violence. And their reaction to that, heroically, was to seek reconciliation rather than revenge. And it's possible, there are people like Gary Haugen, who is one of my heroes, and who started an organization to meet a need. Now, he had that standing because he was Justice Department lawyer, and knew these issues really well. And so it's important to be credentialed sometimes before you undertake those efforts. But he's a great example of someone who took a government experience and then transformed it into an extraordinary ministry. And he did it in ways where they just have a level of expertise that everyone goes to them for information as well as for inspiration. And that can be another real way to affect things. So.
And so let me just say on behalf of Gordon-Conwell, a deep thanks that both of you have been examples in this space, but in the wider culture, of the very things you've been talking about. So we know that it's easier to talk to people like you that share your sentiments, but we know also that you have been in those places where those sentiments haven't been shared and have taken on issues that haven't been ordinary for evangelicals to take on. So a deep word of thanks for sharing with us, to provoke us to good works, to acts of mercy, and to love justice.